Hello and welcome to the Tank Ammo Guide for War Thunder. In this video, I'll be explaining all the different types of shells in the game. From the Shrapnel shell all the way to the different ATGM types, I'll be giving detailed explanations along with visual guides to help you understand each tank shell in the game. The shells can be split up into two basic groups, kinetic energy and chemical energy. Kinetic energy shells rely on mass and velocity to penetrate the enemy armor. The heavier and faster the shell, the more armor it can penetrate. Kinetic energy shells can be split up into three groups, solid AP rounds, high explosive filled AP rounds and subcaliber AP rounds. First up are solid armor piercing rounds, the most basic type of ammunition. These rounds go straight into a plate of armor, penetrate it, and go as far as it can until it runs out of velocity. Knowing where to aim is key with these shells, since they have no post-penetration effects besides spalling, which means the fragmentation of armor. This simple design has three additional variants, namely armor piercing capped, armor piercing ballistic capped, and armor piercing capped ballistic capped. These three are your run-of-the-mill AP shells, but with caps that improve their performances. The APC round features a nose cone made out of a softer metal. This serves two purposes, to transfer the impact shock away from the tip to prevent shattering, and to improve its penetration on angled armor. Because the cap is made out of a softer metal, it'll deform once it reaches armor, leading to the shell rotating to a smaller angle. This process is called normalizing. While the nose cone has its benefits, it'll also decrease the shell's velocity, so it's best to use it at close to medium ranges. Conversely, the ballistic cap on the APBC shell focuses on improving velocity by making it more aerodynamic. This leads to better performances over long distances. The cap collapses once it reaches armor, so it doesn't help with penetration directly. If you can't choose between the two, there's also a third option, APCBC. Like the name suggests, the armor-piercing cap ballistic cap shell combines the nose cone of the APC and the ballistic cap of the APBC shell. This leads to both improved velocity as well as better performances on angled armor, making the APCBC shell very effective. In summary, a basic solid steel shot, an AP shell with a nose cone to help against angled armor, an AP shell with a ballistic cap to improve its velocity, and an AP shell with both a nose cone and a ballistic cap. Next up are high explosive filled armor piercing rounds. As you'd expect, these are AP shells with explosive filler on the inside. After a round penetrates armor, a timed fuse activates the explosives, which results in a lot of internal damage. Because the shells contain this filler though, their penetrating capabilities are slightly lowered, although the explosive factor more than makes up for that. There are four types of APHE shells, APHE, APHEC, APHEBC, and APHECBC. Much like AP, these four only differ in their caps, with APHECBC being the best overall round. Besides the four conventional APHE rounds, there's also the anti-concrete or AC shell. Like the name suggests, AC was designed as an anti-emplacement round to be used against fortifications like pillboxes or bunkers. It's pretty much the same as a regular APHE shell, but with much more explosive filler, leading to a lot more shrapnel and a higher chance of overpressure. In summary, an armor-piercing round that blows up after penetrating a tank, APHE that performs better against angled armor, APHE with improved ballistics, APHE that's good against angled armor and has better ballistics, and a big APHE shell with lots of explosive filler. Next up is the semi-armor piercing shell. SAP is a round featured on naval cannons and howitzers, and is a mix between APHE and regular HE. Compared to APHE, the outer casing of the shell is thinner, and compared to HE, there's less explosive filler. While that may sound bad, these shells are usually quite large in caliber, so penetration values aren't too important. SAP also has a couple of variants like SAP-BC, SAP-CBC, and so on. To learn more about this shell, check out my naval ammo guide, link in description. The next one is a bit of an oddball, namely the shrapnel shell. The round features a thin metal casing surrounding a whole bunch of metal balls as well as a detonator at the rear. Once the detonator activates, the cap flies off and the balls are released inside the target, leading to fragmentation or shrapnel if you will. Because the interior is filled with the shrapnel components instead of structural steel, the shell can't penetrate much armor, which makes it ineffective against armored targets. If it does manage to penetrate though, it can cause a lot of damage. And the final kinetic energy shells are the subcaliber rounds. Instead of the entire shell, these rounds use small and dense cores as penetrators. Due to the size of the core, it can concentrate all its force on a much smaller area, leading to a lot more penetration. But because the core is so small, it can't fit into a regular gun barrel, hence the name subcaliber. To make up for the size difference, the shell needs a casing, or a sabot, which is made out of a softer metal. There's also the issue of post-penetration. The tiny core just punches a hole in the armor and goes through it, leading to almost no spalling. This means you need to aim carefully while using these shells. There are three types of subcaliber rounds: armor-piercing composite rigid, armor-piercing discarding sabot, and armor-piercing fin stabilized discarding sabot. APCR is the most basic type of subcaliber round. Like I explained earlier, the hard core is surrounded by a softer sabot, which travels with the core to the target. Upon impact, the sabot deforms, which lets the core penetrate the target. Typically, the metal used for APCR cores is tungsten carbide, which is a hard yet brittle material. This is where shattering comes in. If the shell face is angled or too much armor, the core will break apart into many little pieces. In short, avoid using APCR against angled armor. APDS, on the other hand, gets rid of a sabot after it leaves the barrel, hence the name discarding sabot. This leads to much better performances in penetration and velocity. In comparison to APCR, the core is made out of a tougher tungsten alloy instead of carbide, leading to less shattering against angled armor. The final and strongest subcaliber round is APFSDS. Much like APDS, the shell discards the sabot after being fired. Unlike APDS though, APFSDS is quite long, which leads to much better post-penetration effects. It also features fins on the back of the shell for better long-distance performance. Older shells like AP, APCR, APDS, and so on are usually fired from rifled cannons, which means they start spinning as they're being fired. This method, known as spin stabilization, helps stabilize shorter rounds over long distances, preventing them from tumbling or veering off course. The longer the shell though, the faster it needs to spin to stay stable, and for really long shells like APFSDS, that speed is almost impossible to reach. So instead, these longer shells use fins to give it the same stabilization, hence the name fin stabilized. Anyway, long explanation over, back to War Thunder. In game, the discarded sabot of APFSDS, which are called sabot petals, can also damage enemy vehicles. While they're not very powerful, they can still be sort of useful in some cases. In summary, a small and dense core surrounded by a soft casing, a faster APCR that gets rid of its casing, and a longer APDS that can travel further and cause more spalling. Up next are the chemical energy shells. Instead of relying on mass and velocity, these shells use chemical reactions to penetrate armor. Since velocity isn't a factor with these shells, they have the same penetration values over all distances. But since they rely on those methods, they'll detonate when they come in contact with anything, so you need to watch out for trees, fences, and other objects in the way. Some tanks also feature spaced, explosive reactive, composite, and other types of armor to counteract these shells, so you'll need to watch out for those as well. There are three main types of chemical energy shells: high explosive, high explosive anti-tank, and guided missiles. First up in the list of chemical energy shells is the high explosive round and all its variants. HE is about as simple as it gets. When it comes in contact with anything, it blows up, leading to shrapnel flying all around the place. As you'd expect, the shell has almost no penetrative capabilities, so it's best used against lightly armored or exposed parts of vehicles. If it's fired from a large caliber gun though, it can deal significantly more damage due to overpressure and the sheer amount of explosive filler. Overpressure is a result of an explosion shockwave compressing the air, by the way. This compression can cause serious damage to both humans and objects, which makes it quite destructive against tanks, but only if it's powerful enough. High explosive also has a couple of variants, starting with high explosive time fuse. The HETF shell features a timed fuse, which detonates after a set distance. You can set this distance by using a rangefinder. In real life, this shell was designed for flat cannons to be used against aircraft. It's pretty much useless in game though, since rangefinding a moving plane is quite difficult. A more modern variant of HETF is high explosive variable time fuse. The HEVT shell also blows up after a set distance, but this time that distance isn't predetermined. Instead, the shell itself has a proximity sensor that automatically detects enemies near it. This can be extremely useful against aircraft, since all you need to do is fire the shell close to the target. Against tanks though, not so much. A more obscure shell is the high explosive grenade. This round was specially designed to be fired from recoilless rifles. Due to their unconventional charges, their velocity is usually pretty bad, so they can't travel too far. When they come in contact with a target, they perform essentially the same as a high explosive round though. Speaking of, the next shell is the anti-personnel fragmentation grenade. The VOG, which is a Russian acronym for fragmentation grenade round, was designed to be used against infantry. Think of it like a very powerful machine gun round. A couple of bursts can take out tracks, barrels, exposed parts of vehicles, and can clear terrain elements like bushes or trees. And the final high explosive shell is the rocket. A rocket is basically an unguided self-propelled high explosive round, which usually holds a lot of explosive filler. They are pretty inaccurate though, and their effects are usually minimal, only damaging the gun barrel or the tracks. If the target is lightly armored or if it's a large caliber rocket however, the enemy can't go down in a single hit. In summary, a round that blows up when it comes in contact with a target, an HE round that blows up after a set distance, an HE round that blows up when it detects something near it, a low velocity HE round, a smaller and less powerful HE round, and an unguided self-propelled HE round. Next up is the high explosive squash head round. HESH is one of the more unique shells in the game. Instead of penetrating armor, it uses the enemy's armor against itself. When it comes in contact with a target, the plastic explosive tip of the round squishes onto the armor, hence the name squash head. Afterwards, the same plastic explosive detonates, causing a shockwave to go through the armor. This leads to the surface on the inside to rupture, sending pieces of metal shards inside the tank at high speeds. Theoretically, BESH can be quite destructive, but in game, it's pretty lackluster, unless it's a really large caliber round. Following HESH's high explosive anti-tank, another interesting round. Heat rounds are designed with a couple of key components, namely an explosive charge, a detonator, and a cone-shaped metal liner, which is usually made of copper. When the round comes in contact with a target, the explosives detonate, which causes the liner to collapse into an extremely high velocity jet of metal. This jet is focused through the tip of the round and into the target. When the jet comes in contact with the armor, it acts as a kinetic penetrator, and thanks to its incredibly high velocity, it can chew through a lot of metal. The drawback of this design, however, is that the jet of metal is focused on a very small area with not much spalling, so you'll have to know where to aim. Like high explosive, heat also has a couple of variants, starting with HEATFS. High explosive anti-tank fin stabilized is a more modern heat round, using better penetrative chemicals and having fins in the back of the shell. Similar to APFSDS, the fins exist to compensate for the smoothbore cannons featured on modern MBTs. On regular heat shells, spinning is actually counterintuitive. The shaped charge tries to focus the jet into a small area, but if the round spins, the jet will spread around more, leading to less force and thus less penetration. Thanks to smoothbore cannons, all this can be avoided, and the fins at the back of HEATFS can help stabilize the shell while traveling. Next up is a pretty obscure round, namely high explosive anti-tank multi-purpose. HEATMP rounds are just HEATFS rounds with a proximity fuse. Unlike HEVT though, the proximity fuse only detonates above a specific altitude, so you can still use it as a HEATFS round against ground targets. If you pair it with your laser rangefinder, it can be pretty useful to shoot down helicopters and such. And the last heat variant is the heat grenade. Like the high explosive grenade, these rounds are specially designed to be fired from recoilless rifles. Due to their low muzzle velocity, they can't travel very far, but at close range, they're as effective as your run-of-the-mill heat round. In summary, a round that sends a jet of very fast metal through a tank, a modern heat round, a HEATFS round with a proximity sensor that activates in the sky, and a low velocity heat round. The last major group is the anti-tank guided missile with all its variants. In-game, the most basic type of ATGM is essentially a rocket-propelled heat round they can control. The type of control or the guidance of these missiles can be quite varied, so let's go over those now. First up is manual command to line of sight, or MCLOS. This is the most primitive type of guidance. You have to guide the missile yourself using either your keyboard or your gamepad. Next is semi-automatic command to line of sight, or SACLOS. Instead of constantly guiding the missile, all you need to do is point your crosshair at the target, and it will guide itself towards it. And the last guidance system is fire and forget. After locking a target, information like coordinates, velocity, or the infrared image of the enemy is programmed into the missile. After launching, you don't have to guide it or even look at the target, so you can quite literally forget about the enemy. Now that that's out of the way, let's take a look at the variants of the ATGM. The first variant is the ATGM Overfly Top Attack. Instead of flying directly towards the target, the ATGM-OTA first gains some altitude and then descends to hit the target's roof, where the armor is usually weakest. Next up is the Proximity Fuse ATGM, or ATGM-VT. This missile does what you'd expect. You guide it towards the target, and it blows up when it detects an enemy near it. It's quite useful against air targets. The next guided missile is a pretty interesting one, namely the Tandem Charge ATGM. This missile uses a twin-stage warhead to overcome explosive reactive armor, or ERA. When the first warhead comes in contact with a target, it blows up, clearing any ERA that may stand in its path. This opens the way for the second warhead to come in direct contact with the armor of the target. Next is a pretty simple one, namely the high explosive ATGM. Instead of a shaped heat charge, these missiles just use explosive filler. This means it's pretty much just a rocket that you can control. In the same fashion is ATGM-AP, or armor piercing. This round isn't technically classified in-game, but I thought I'd include it nevertheless. ATGM-AP is a rocket-propelled kinetic penetrator, which penetrates more armor the further it travels. Think of it like a really big APFSDS round. When it's first launched, it's quite slow, but after it gains some speed, it can be quite destructive. Currently, it's only featured on the low side, but it might be added to other vehicles in the future. And the last guided missile is the surface-to-air one. The SAM is a proximity-fused fire-and-forget missile designed purely for anti-air purposes. All you need to do is lock the target and launch. SAMs include a variety of different missile types, from heat-seeking to radar-guided and many more. I go into deeper detail about the different types of anti-air missiles in my AAM guide, so check that out if you want some more information. In summary, a rocket-propelled heat round that you can control, an ATGM that flies towards the top of a target after gaining altitude, an ATGM that blows up when it detects something near it, an ATGM with two warheads to overcome ERA, a rocket-propelled HE round that you can control, a big rocket-propelled AP round that you can control, and an anti-air missile that guides itself. And the very last round we'll be talking about is the smoke shell. This round, unlike all the others we mentioned, is not for anti-vehicle purposes. Instead, you can use it to conceal your position or mess with your enemies. Some strategies include firing it close to your location, firing it somewhere you'll be going, or firing it at your enemies. The smoke lasts about 20 seconds, which is plenty of time if you use them correctly. And that about covers it. I hope you enjoyed the video. I want to thank everybody for 50,000 subscribers. When I released the first couple tank ammo guides, I didn't expect them to explode in views like that, but look at the channel now. This time, I did a lot more research on how the shells actually work, so I hope you understood the shells. I even had to learn Blender from scratch, and while the animations are a bit choppy at times, I still put my best into them. If you have any questions or you noticed something wrong about the video, please leave a comment. Other than that, thanks for watching and happy April Fools.